Now, China's ambassador to the UK, Liu Xiaoming, says the British government should revise its travel advice to avoid panic. Speaking to Sky News, the ambassador denied that China had tried to cover up the early stages of the outbreak. He said that the rate of people dying from the disease is now falling and Beijing is ready to collaborate with the rest of the world.
And we are confident that we have a capability to win the battle against the virus. And the Prime Minister spoke highly of China's efforts, China's contribution, and appreciate highly the speed, effectiveness of the measure taken by China. And President Xi also said we are open, transparent in terms of collaboration with the international community, including the UK.
Well, I'm joined now by Dian Weiling, Chinese author and former business professor, and in central London by Matthew Henderson, director of the Asia Studies Centre at the Henry Jackson Society. Good evening to both of you. Dian, let's start here in the studio, shall we? The Chinese ambassador seemed to be very appreciative of the UK's response to the coronavirus outbreak. Seemingly warm words from him. What was your attitude to it?
I watched that interview, and that's the feeling that I get. And when I read the Chinese press, and the feeling has been, this is a crucial moment for China and Chinese healthcare, and the whole government and working situations are under enormous pressure. And so, as the Chinese say, a friend in need is a friend indeed. And when the UK offered sympathy, help, and support to China's effort trying to contain this outbreak, and China is very appreciative, not only to UK, but to other countries that had so far offered support and help, including Germany, for example, from the European Union.
But contrasting, possibly one might say, the United States, is that the contrast we're looking at here?
Well, in the case of the United States, things are a little different. And when the outbreak took place, took hold of Wuhan, when Wuhan was the city in Hubei province was under lockdown, and US became the first country to evacuate its citizens, and it's banned flights to China, banned Chinese citizens to travel to America very quickly. And at the same time, and Chinese government thought that America, being one of the most advanced in disease control, seemed to be slow in offering help to China. On top of that, Trump's Commerce Secretary, Wilbur Ross, said in an interview that given that China has the virus and this is a great opportunity for Americans to take back the jobs that they lost to China. So all these, add up to the ongoing trade wars that happened between China and America in the past 2-3 years. And so the feelings towards America in this time of need for the Chinese people and Chinese government is rather cool, if we can say.
Say that, yes, indeed. Matthew Henderson, do you think Downing Street really does appreciate the enormous difficulties facing China now in dealing with this coronavirus and the strict controls they've brought in? Or is this something of a calculated response from Downing Street, their understanding of how important China is as a global player in a post-Brexit world? It's hard to see and not to see everything through that prism these days.
I think it's very important to concentrate on the facts. Expressions of sympathy are deserved and needed, and they are very welcome. But the fact is that an epidemic is as bad as it starts. And it seems very clear that the disease broke out in December. The lockdown doesn't come until the latter part of January. As late as the 19th of January, huge civil celebrations were taking place in Wuhan when the mayor knew perfectly well that he had a problem. So let's not talk unrealistically about the way in which, from the very word go, quite serious errors were clearly made, to the point that, as we know, senior provincial and municipal level officials have been replaced. There clearly were problems, and these problems may well have resulted in the much more rapid spread in the early stages of the disease, before it was fully understood what the risks were, and have resulted perhaps in its rocketing to such a high level of infectivity now.
That is an interesting point, isn't it, Diane? Help us understand how China might operate in these circumstances. Would the provincial leaders that Matthew raised there have acted in the old way, as China did with SARS, for example, to try and cover this up? And then it was recognised at a national level that that was not the way to deal with this now that China is a global country.
Mistakes definitely had been made. And the issue with pandemic like this is that you must nip the problem in the bud. But once that virus had gone all around China, especially during the Chinese New Year, when 500 million people were on the road going to visit family, and that became a huge problem. And the government had since demoted or fired the provincial leaders of Hubei province. However, this goes much deeper, even though this might not be the right time, as China's still fighting the outbreak, to be looking at the cause and responsibility. But definitely mistakes were made, and possibly, and it has a deeper problem in China, not only in terms of the hierarchies between the central government and provincial government, but also how the Chinese political system tend to place a lot more emphasis on control, stability, rather than free flow of information.
Yes, it shows a changing China in some respects, doesn't it? But the ambassador also discussed a future trade deal between the UK and China. Let's have a listen to what he said.
Last year, the British government is so focused on Brexit. I hope this year, after you have Brexit done, I think your top priority is still negotiating with your EU partners. China is open and ready to engage with the UK to reach a new agreement, trade agreement.
So, Matthew, open and ready China is. Is that great news, do you think, for those in Downing Street or those negotiating future trade deals?
I think you have to look at the detail. Things like the attempt to offer a five-year and much cheaper version of our high-speed rail looked a little bit aggressive and a little bit patronising. The point is, what is really in Britain's best interests? Do we fully understand what those interests are in regard to specific high-level items of business of that sort? And have we worked out what our options are before we leap too quickly into arrangements we may later come to regret? And I would hesitate to include perhaps Huawei in that same scenario.
Well, indeed so. The US, as we know, are fearful of China on issues like Huawei, on its global domination, possibly. This people say, is China's century. Is this an indication that Boris Johnson's government is not being warned off by America on Huawei and elsewhere?
Well, at the end of the day, our best friends are those who ally with us closely and understand risks generally across the world and share understanding through the intelligence relationships that link us with our five A's partners. I think as a matter of general principle, it's very sensible indeed to give them careful attention. And I note that senior officials will be once again, after many previous visits in the same vein, coming to London tomorrow for talks about the problems with Huawei.
Diane, does the UK want a trade deal with China? Cheap products, for example, cheap steel as well, questionable business practices, accusations that they steal intellectual property rights, questionable human rights issues too, the Uyghurs currently, for example. What sort of relationship should the UK have with China?
Well, given China is the second largest economy in the world, and given that UK is a very big economy in Europe, and there is great benefit to doing business between the two countries. And in terms of business practices, and clearly China has a different political system. And in terms of business such as Huawei, such as Chinese railway companies. And these are very much world-leading companies. And Huawei has been involved with over 100 countries in their 3G, 4G network. And in some cases, 5G network. And there has not been any case of spying. And there's still debatable whether there's evidence that Huawei is capable of building in what's so-called backdoor to their 5G network. In terms of the railway and HS2 project, and I do think China has had great experience in building roads and railways, and it has built roads and railways in not only China, across Asia and in Africa.
Well, in fact, the ambassador did suggest that was fake news, didn't he? The promise of HS2 being built in 5 years and so on. But let me go back to Matthew. China does, though, offer some nice solutions, or at least some money to these big infrastructure projects, doesn't it? Even though HS2, as I said, the ambassador suggested had been misreported to a certain degree. It was David Cameron and George Osborne, wasn't it, that started this love affair with China. Is it right to continue to do so if we are going it alone outside the European Union? Do we seek friends everywhere?
I think the phrase love affair is a very good one, and in those days it certainly seemed that way. But you shouldn't really allow love and emotions of that sort and the very emotive way in which these relationships are described in maximalist terms, golden eras and so on, to blur the reality of today's world. Today's world is highly competitive. It's competitive in ways which in certain systems are not as fair as we would wish. There are standards, there are techniques and there are methods which are those that Britain adheres to, that we believe in. And when we ally ourselves too closely with states and systems and indeed with businesses who don't behave according to those standards, we are letting ourselves down and we're laying ourselves open to risk, particularly when it comes to key infrastructure and particularly when it comes to owning our own data. Ownership of data is going to be ownership of security. It already is to a very high extent.
Well, and things Matthew, that compromise.